Attending this conference, Playtime Solution for the North. This conference is a conference to bring awareness to the problems that we have here in the Arctic Circle. Today's program is it's a quite tight program, and now we're starting half an hour late. So if people can be on time after the breaks and come back in time, inshallah. The lunch and dinner will be provided for all the guests upstairs. Will be the lunch, and there'll be dinner in Al-Noor Centre at the end of the conference, inshallah. Also, there'll be food at the back. Be serving all day. You can just help yourselves to the food, inshallah. Could people please turn off their mobile phones and have it on silent so it's not a disturbance to the conference, inshallah. We'd like to start the conference now with a Quran presentation by Brother Naji Disasa.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والشمس وضحاها والقمر إذا تلاها والنهار إذا جلاها والليل إذا يغشاها والسماء وما بناها والأرض وما طحاها ونفس وما سواها فألهمها فجورها وتقواها قد أفلح من زكاها وقد خاب من دساها كذبت ثمود بطغواها إذ انبعث أشقاها فقال لهم رسول الله ناقة الله وسقياها فكذبوه فعقروها فدمدم عليهم ربهم بذنبهم فسواها ولا يخاف عقباها أقم الصلاة لدلوك الشمس إلى غسق الليل وقرآن الفجر إن قرآن الفجر كان مشهودا ومن الليل فتهجد به نافلة لك عسى أن يبعثك ربك مقاما محمودا وقل رب أدخلني مدخل صدق وأخرجني مخرج صدق واجعل لي من لدنك سلطانا مبينا واجعل لي من لدنك سلطانا نصيرا وقل جاء الحق وزهق الباطل إن الباطل كان زهوقا وننزل من القرآن ما هو شفاء ورحمة للمؤمنين ولا يزيد الظالمين إلا خسارا ويقول تعالى في سورة النور هو الذي جعل الشمس ضياء والقمر نورا وقدره منازل لتعلموا عدد السنين والحساب وكل شيء فصلناه تفصيلا وكل إنسان ألزمناه طائره في عنقه ونخرج له يوم القيامة كتابا يلقاه منشورا اقرأ كتابك كفى بنفسك اليوم عليك حسيبا من اهتدى فإنما يهتدي لنفسه ومن ضل فإنما يضل عليها ولا تزر وازرة وزر أخرى وما كنا معذبين حتى نبعث رسولا. هذه الآية في سورة الإسراء. صدق الله العظيم.
Okay, now we'd like to have a welcome introduction from the two Islamic centers here in Tromsø, and I'd like to ask Brother Jama Muhammad Jama from the Islamic Center of Northern Norway.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I would like to announce, dear brothers and sisters in Islam, we welcome all of you to the conference on prayer times of the Arctic Circle area. We are very grateful to your participation, and we extend special thanks and gratitude to you too. Guests coming from other parts of Norway, from UK and Turkey. I would like to address two main issues. First, I will talk about our organization, Islamic Center of Northern Norway. And then secondly, I will give a short history and the process of making prayer timetables for Tromsø and other parts of Northern Norway. It's a happy day because today we have two Muslims here in Tromsø, and there is a lot of Muslims who are settling here. But if I go back to the history, before we established our mosque, Al-Rahma Masjid, we used to pray only Salatul Jum'ah at the youth house, Umtum Sussei Tromsø. The youth house was originally intended into a place for youth activities and music, and it's not for a place for a prayer, and not appropriate for a worship or salat. We tried very hard to find another place, but we couldn't. And eventually, we realized we need an organization, a religious organization, to get a mosque, and then we have get a members, apply funding from the county and municipality. In 1992, we founded an Islamic Center for Northern Norway. In 1993, we opened the first mosque ever established in Northern Norway. Today we use the same building as the one we rented in 1993 for 19 years, and we call it Al-Rahma Mosque. And we have a normal activities. We pray 5 times a day. We give teaching Quran for the children, adults, both women and men. They study Quran and religious safaris and religious studies. We cooperate with Al Noor when we are arranging Eid, Al Fitr, Eid Al Adha, and we rent a big hall, and we pray together all Muslims. We have marriage authorities, and we have a burial privileges. Those who pass away, and we have many activities at the mosque. And the second thing that I would like to talk is a prayer timetable. According to the Norwegian almanac, we have in Tromsø a dark period between November 27 and up to the January 14. When the sun disappears, there is no sunrise on all this period. The midnight sun period between May 18 and 25 of July, when there is no sunset, the sun disappears. After we opened the mosque, our first challenge was to figure out how to set up a prayer timetable. This was difficult, and we did not have a knowledge to make a prayer timetable. Then we got the fatwa, which says you can use the prayer timetable of nearest town or country which have an ordinary sunrise and sunset. We decided to follow Oslo, the capital of Norway. Oslo has the largest Muslim community in Norway, and we use it to pray timetable for Oslo between 93 and 2003. 10 years we have been using because we don't have ability to make a better timetable. And then the Biba Al-Masad file, we tried another solution. We get a filter from UK, and we in the first option was to use the timetable nearest town or the country. We have tried that one. The second option was to from your local prior timetable, you can pick a day which has a very average prior timetable and free start time. Then use the schedule of this day during the dark and the midnight some years. We used this schedule for several years, and then we found out this was not enough. So then we get across another photo from Saudi Arabia, which says during the dark and the summer night sun period, you can use prior times, prior timetable for Makkah al-Mukarrama of Saudi Arabia. This is the one we have using until now. Eventually, we hope to find out a permanent solution to this issue. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Brother Jamal. Okay, next we'd like to call up Sandra Mary Moe, manager of Al Noor Centre, to say some few words.
Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to Tromsø and this conference about prayer times. People have traveled from many cities in Norway to join this conference. We have guests from Hammerfest, high up in the north, Narvik, Finnsnes, Harstad, Skibotn, Vesterålen, Bodø, Trondheim, and Oslo. We also have guests all the way from Turkey and England, and we are very happy to have you all here with us today. Majority of the participants in this conference are active in mosque organizations, and we have gathered here to try and find solutions for the prayer time problems of the north. Al Noor Center and Islam Center for Northern Norway are the two local mosques in Tromsø and have been cooperating in organizing this conference today. So I would like to take this opportunity to thank all the brothers and sisters who have been working very hard for those several weeks to arrange this conference. Thank you. We could not have done this without you. This will be a unique and interesting conference with lectures, dialogue and debates. And we hope this conference will be beneficial to everyone and bring many solutions to the prayer time problems. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. Okay, our first speaker is a servant, Bayadia, and he has come from Istanbul University in Turkey, and he's going to make a speech today. And the speech is titled Historical Fiqh Background for the Prayer Times in the Arctic Circle.
Okay. I'll just open it. Assalamu alaikum. Elhamdülillahi Rabbil Alemin ve salatu ve selamu ala Resulina Muhammedin ve ala alihi ve sahbihi ecma'in. Dear brothers and sisters, first of all I thanks for Allah because he gathering us the very important the issue that inshallah we will solve this problem. And also I would like to thanks Al Noor Center and his chairman, Sandra Maria Mo, because this is the third time we are coming here, and every time they made us feel such as our home. And also there are so many brothers and sisters here. They helped us every our researchers. And also we have Professor Adnan Oktan and Professor Abdulaziz Bayındır and Professor Saim Yeprem, who are the experts in this subject. Especially Adnan Oktan, he is an astronom, and Saim Yeprem is professor in Turkish religious affairs. He was ahead of very important point, and he made so many times a calendars. And as you know, and also Professor Abdulaziz Bayındır, he tried to solve this problem according to Quran. Why? Because according to Quran, when our brother received the Quranic verses, in the Quran says, وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَلَا يَزِيدُ الظَّالِمِينَ إِلَّا خَسَارًا. Allah Ta'ala says, Quran is a shifa. But unfortunately, we forgot this verse, so many words, and also this verse. Quran, today's ma'al asaf, lil asaf, unfortunately, doesn't give us a shifa. So we should solve our problems firstly based on the Quran and also our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's hadith. So my presentation will be about this historical and fiqh background this issue. I will not touch in today's our solution because our professor Abdulaziz Bayındır, he will talk about our offers. As we know, the knowledge of starting and ending time for prayer is one of the most important issue for Muslims, as mentioned our brothers. Why? Because not only for Muslim, it is also for Christians and Judaists, because they have so many prayers which are related to times. But they also they have a problem. If we solve this problem, inshallah, we will help our Christians and Judaist human beings. As you know, there are six main requirements for salat, for prayer, and one of them is time. Because ensuring the time for the prayer time has arrived, if we pray the time, if we pray the salat without time, it will be invalid. So this issue, we can say, this debating is started, we can say the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or we can say after the second Hijri. Why I say? Because there is a long hadith. It is called Dajjal hadith. In the hadith, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam talking about very long days, and the companions asked, how I will be pray, O Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? He answered, you must estimate, fakturu. So if we say, for example, this hadith is original, sahih, we can say this debate or this idea is started from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's time. Or if somebody says this hadith is mawdu, also we can conclude that this problem started from the second Hijri. Because why? These hadith books, Muslim, Abu Dawud, Tirmizi, and Ahmad bin Hanbal Musnad, this hadith is written in their books. For example, Muslim, Imam Muslim, rahmatullahi alayh, was passed away 261 Hijri. So this problem is very long
background. What is the problem? You know better than us. I'll touch a little bit. The five prayer times, they have been clearly explained in so many hadith. Jibril hadith is a very mashhur, famous hadith. And especially in Isha time and Fajr time. But according to these hadith and fiqh rulings, Isha begins with the disappearance of the red twilight, and Fajr begins the appearance of the white twilight. Dhuhr is offered after the sun passing its meridian from the east to west, and Asr performed when the positions of somebody his shadow twice and plus the original shadow, and Maghrib is offered after disappearance of the sun's disk below the horizon, but these signs are not occur in everywhere at every time, as you know, especially in this area, especially the ranges between 48 to 90 degree to north and south. What said the classical, what said our ulama, scholars in classical times about this issue? Very shortly, I will not to go into deep. There are mainly three opinions. One opinion is prayer order falls. Some Hanafi scholars, they say, this according to this approach, since the legal signs doesn't exist, for example, Isha prayer isn't be performed. This opinion depends on analogy as washing hands and feet in wudu, not obligatory for the person whose hands or feet cut off. If he has no hand, the washing of hand is fall. So, if he has no time, prayer the time, related to time, cut off. For example, there is a big scholar, Shahabuddin al-Marjani, he's from Kazan. He has a Nazratul Haq, is a very valuable book about this issue. He talk about all these opinions. The second opinion, and the famous opinion, and the largest opinion, is the estimation. We can find every classical mazahibs, they offer this opinion. This view belongs to especially Shafi and majority of the Hanafi scholars, and also Maliki scholars, and also Hanbali scholars. For example, the Shafi scholar Shirbini said in his book, in his valuable book, in nearest normal region, for example, if in nearest normal region, if the twilight disappears in one quarter of night, this can be taken as a criteria for estimating Isha time, when he's talking about Isha time, in an abnormal region, such as Svalbard, yesterday we saw. Ibn Abidin, when he was talking about the fasting time, it is necessary to estimate the time for starting and breaking the fast. He says, he is answering the other Hanafi scholars. He says, yani, you should not say the prayer or fasting cut off. And there is another opinion, I didn't write it. They say, you don't offer this prayer, you should make a qada, you should make a qada. This is another opinion. But what are their
evidence, as I mentioned before, there is a hadith, very long hadith. According to the hadith, companions asked Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he talked about Dajjal's time, O Messenger of Allah, how long will he stay in earth, Dajjal? Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam answered, 40 days. One day will be like a year. One day will be like a month. One day will be like a week. And the rest of the days will be like your days or like your Jum'ah. Companions asked, O Messenger of Allah, will one day's prayers suffice for the prayers of the day that will be equal to 1 year? Thereupon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, no, you must estimate the timings. Faqduru, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. Maybe as I said, if the hadith is original, this idea is starting from the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If the hadith, let's say, is mawdu, this debate or this idea started from the of the second Hijri Prophet from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Okay, what contemporary scholars said about this issue? There are so many ideas, as you know, because when we go to the Al-Nur Center, we saw so many calendars. When we talked with Brother Ibrahim, Sister Maryam, and other Muslim brothers, they are talking about so many criteria. Everybody offered their solutions. Such as the principle, solution or one opinion, nearest day, akrab al-yawm. The principle based on, in generally, Hanafi scholars. They say, for those places where during a period of time the twilight doesn't end, the time for sahur, for example, if we talk about sahur, the time for sahur for this abnormal period will be taken as the time for the last day on which the twilight ended. The akrab al-ayyam day. This is an example here. And the second opinion, nearest latitude, akrab al-balad. This principle is due to fellow jurists. Generally, Shafi scholars. They say the difference of time between the beginning of twilight and the sunrise at 48 degrees latitude is calculated. Should be the main criteria, the 48 degree. The same difference is maintained between the end of sahur and sunrise. This formula is applied for the locality, for example, in Tromsø, for which the sahur time is to be evaluated. So you can use for every prayer time this formula. The third opinion is middle of the nine, nisfa layl criteria. This principle is due to the later jurists. The period from sunset and sunrise is divided into two halves. The first half is considered to be night, and the other half is a daybreak. So, thus, the time for sahur, if we talk about the sahur, this is an example, sahur will end at the midpoint because of the night's finish. I think it should be fourth opinion, 1/7 of ninth criteria, sab'a min al-layl. This principle is again attributed to the recent jurists. The period between sunset and sunrise is divided into 7 parts. During the 6/7 of the period following the sunrise, it is recommended that the people make sahur. The time limit for the sahur will be 1/7 for part of the night before sunrise. So this criteria can be applied for every prayer times. The fourth or the fifth opinion, combination between Maghrib and Isha, especially 45 and 48 degrees, or 48 to 66 degrees. So, but this opinion hasn't been famous. The contemporary, there are some scholars that talk about this issue. For example, Muhammad Abdu, Mahmud Shaltut, Mustafa Al-Zarqa. For example, Mustafa Al-Zarqa is talking against the fatwa of the Hay'at-i Kibar al-Ulama. He says you can't apply your criteria to Meccan time on this area. It is not suitable. It will be cause harm. Makasid, mefsada. It will be cause a mefsada, not maslaha, he says. And there are so many scholars. For example, Sheikh Ghadi al-Haq, Ali Jum'a, now he's a mufti of the, as we know, in Egypt. Muhammad Hamidullah, his valuable book in Islam, he talks about this issue. And lastly, I read, there is a valuable article about Sheikh Ali Muhyiddin al-Qaradari. He also talking about this, and he offered two solutions, or Meccan time, estimate Meccan, or take a criteria of Meccan time, or the local time. And also there are so many organizations that are trying to solve this problem. For example, the board of fatwa in Amman, Muslim World League Fiqh Council, it is very important. They worked very hard about this issue. Thanks for him. OIC Fiqh Council, which they say we accept the Muslim World League Fiqh Council's opinions. Also, and they applied the first opinions. And also, there is a Turkish Higher Committee for Religious Affairs, who is our Professor Sayyid Yabram. He was the chairman of this body. And they have, I think, inshallah, he will talk about the history, what they made, what they offered for Muslims. But in shortly, they made a conference between Muslim World League Fiqh Council in 982, I think, if I don't miss, 82, and they offered some solutions for Muslim. After that, they applied their upgrade their solutions, and in generally, Muslims, Turkish Muslims, like these areas, they follow this solution. But the idea, I can say, in my opinion, inshallah we will listen our professor, the same idea with in the criteria, the estimation criteria. They take estimation criteria. Okay, this is the Fiqh Council's fatwa, and this fatwa and generally modern scholars' ideas, how they implement. This is a earth, huh? They divided the earth. Is it possible? Divided the earth mainly two parts. The first part from the equator to the 45 latitude, and the second part from the 45 latitude to the 90 latitude from the pole. So they say this area is the normal area.
So what we should do, we should calculate our prayer times according to our legal texts, fiqh, hadith, etc. And but the second part, this is the problematic area. So they say, they call abnormal area or extreme area, they call. So they divide this second part into three parts, as you know. The first part from 45 latitude to 48 latitude. They say there is a problem, we can say there is a problem, but this problem can be eliminated. So the Muslims who live in this area should follow these rulings. But from 48 degrees to 68.66, etc., there is a problem. They accept there's a problem because especially Aisha time and Fajr time sometime appear. So what we should do? They disappears, yeah. So they say, according to their fatwa, we should take a criteria the aqrab
nearest.
The nearest area 45 degrees. So if, for example, on this meridian, if somebody lives here, he took a criteria the place that the nearest meridian and the same meridian and the nearest area, and this all of prayer times here, which is a normal area, should take a criteria all of this until 66 latitude. But problem, what should we do after 66 to 90s? Also they say we can make a criteria from Meccan time or also the nearest area. But so many scholars I read their opinions, they say we should take a Meccan time. But there is no, for example, in the Ali Muhyiddin Karadağ also, he preferred this criteria. But when we ask, why Meccan time? Who said Meccan time should be taken the criteria? Is there any hadith? Or is there any ayah? He says, yes, there are no so many ayah. What? Which ayah? قَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى أُمُّ الْقُرْآنِ. Why? Because the Mecca holy city, the Ummul Qur'an. Yes. But which ayah says us, for example, in Svalbard or in Tromsø, you should take the criteria as Meccan time? And this person in Sami, they when before 2 years ago, 200 ago, how they can know Mecca, what time is Mecca now? Was there an internet? Was there a telephone? Was there a watch? No. Why? Because they couldn't get a sound criteria until now. Why? I can say, but inshallah our professor Abdulaziz Bahindar will say deeply, clearly, inshallah, they don't take the Quran as a criteria. This is the problem. They use a hadith, Dajjal hadith. Yes, Dajjal hadith. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam assume that it is original. He's talking about in Mecca, yes. But he doesn't talk about in Svalbard or in Tromsø. So this is a problem.
mentality problem. This problem is not only for prayer times. Every problem, Muslims' problem, especially in fiqh, I can say because I am a Sharia expert, I don't know the other area. Especially in fiqh, they, most of them, they don't take a criteria, the Quranic verses. So their solutions can't be an answer to our problems. So they offer a solution, but this solution causes a new problem. This solution causes a new problem, new problem, new problem. So when a Norwegian here, a Christian, for example, when he look at our calendars or our debatements, what he say? Can he say, oh, this is a very good religion, I should accept, I should be a Muslim? No. If I can, a Norwegian, I say no. They don't know their prayer times. How I can accept their religion? This is our problem. We should solve the problem. Thanks for Al-Nur Center and other audiences, professors. They come, they gathered here to make an awareness this problem. Inshallah, this is the maybe first step. Nearest time, inshallah, we will solve this problem. Thanks all of audience. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Thank you very much for that. I'd just like to point out, if anyone has any questions ongoing any of the lectures today, there'll be a chance later in the panel debate where we'll be able to take questions and answers for that, inshallah. Okay, our next speaker is Professor Adnan Uktan from Istanbul University in Turkey, and his talk will be How the Prayer Times Are Calculated to a Calendar. Don't hold it 2 points.
No, maybe. Thank you very much, Servet Stol. He gave us very good information about this topic. And now I will give you how the prayer times convert to a calendar. So before my talk about the prayer times, I would like to give my appreciate to the organizer committee to coordinate this meeting. This kind of organizations are very important to supply a consensus between the believers. This is very important to supply a consensus between the believers. I hope that at the end of this one-day meeting, the organizing committee can reach a conclusion about the prayer times, especially for the active patients. Thanks again, these beautiful organizations. First of all, I would like to give you some information about the universe. I am not sure that everybody knows where we are living. Of course, we are living on the Earth, and how the motions between the Sun and Earth, Earth and Moon, and the universe about what we know, how it's created, what the scientists say about the universe creations, because you know the some hypotheses they argue, and if the argue hypotheses can be supplied with experimentally, we can believe this kind of theories. So then I will try to give you some criteria of the prayer times and what kind of formula of the prayer times and what kind of formula we have to take into account to solve this problem. So,
aşağıda açık hocam, aşağıda açık.
Seçemiyor ki gözüm.
PowerPoint'te gidelim. PowerPoint'in üzerine. Ha, onda.
Okay. Yani. No problem. I hope I can open. As you know, we are living on a cosmic body. Its special name is the Earth. Also, Servet used this items for the Earth. Or more commonly, the public use is the world. We are living on a world. I don't want to give you numerical values, but if we need, I will say something. The Earth formed about 4.5 billion years ago. This is a very long time when we compare the human life. And life appeared on its surface within about 1 million years ago. The Earth is third planet after the Sun, because the solar system, the primary object of the system is the Sun, and other planets, it's about, we rejected the Pluto, you see on the screen. Because the Pluto's orbits crossing the other orbits, and also many Pluto's type objects founded on these regions. Other planets, Mercury, Venus, Dunya, the third one. Maybe we can see is the Moon revolving around the Earth. The giant planets is the gas planets, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, Neptune. The Sun's gravitational fields holds all these objects, around the circle, the Sun. And we compare the dimensions. The great one is yellow, represents the Sun, and the echelon is true, the giant planets. Here is the Earth, very small. Its diameter 12,000 kilometers. When we compare the Sun is 1,400,000 kilometers. Very huge plasmic ball. And in the center of the Sun, nuclear reactions produce the energy. The protons comes together, reach the Coulomb barrier and exploding. Not a hydrogen bomber, it is a fusion reactions produced. Here is the gamma rays, and there are many different layers, and this gamma rays reduce the energy up to level of this limb, the photosphere. We saw on the Earth a visible light. All wavelengths come to the Earth, but the Earth's atmosphere filters to live on the Earth's the living organized. So, and is a representation, another good picture, only to show. Here is the another bodies between the Mars and Jupiter. The asteroid belts, some rocky sometimes comes to Earth, comes to other planets sometimes fall to Earth. We know it's about 65 million years ago, where a giant, it's about 10 kilometer diameter, and an asteroid fall to the Earth. The 90%, more than 90% species destroyed at this time. And again, very good pictures. Here is another belt, Kuiper belt. This is the comet's source. Most of the comets comes from here. You know the comets, they produce a line when the comets approach the sun, because the sun's photon pressure extends the gas parts of the these objects behind, and sometimes these parts break from the comet's nuclei. When the Earth crosses these orbital parts, we saw the meteor shower. And the sun's gravitational force extends very, very high places. Here is the, if you take into account the only planets, it is gravitational effect extends to Neptune, 4.5 billion kilometers. This is very long distance when we compare the Earth's distance, because we are living on the Earth. We know the speeds, for example, a car going 100 kilometers per second, and the distance is about 1,000 kilometers. Here's the distance very long, and also time is very long when we compare the human life. And a few sentences about the universe. The scientists suppose the some theoretical aspects, because when they said the universe must be expanded, and they said background radiation must be some value, and the percentage of the matter distribution they said. So after the observations, we saw the expansion is real. When we look to the very high galaxies and quasars, all these objects, very high speeds going to away from us. When we look to the spectrum of these objects, we see the red line of the red parts of the spectrum, these lines, we actually know this expansion is real. The background radiations, the calculation gives us the whole universe must be about 3 Kelvin degree. This is also isotropically observed for the scientists, and we saw the whole universe 3 degree Kelvin is possible after the observations. The percentage of the matter, also the distribution of the matter in the universe, it is 75% is the hydrogen, more abundant element, 25% helium, only very small percent the heavier element. And we now believe the universe is created. It's about 14 billion years ago with a very strong explosion. It is the name the scientific use, the Big Bang. And we know the moon revolve around the Earth. It shows the face. It depends the sunlight where it comes. And the new moon, I mean the lights comes from here, the sunlight, the new moon. And the other all phases possible to see it. The opposite size, the full moon. We know also these pictures. This is a representation to see not all phases, but from the crescent and full moon about the other phases of the moon. Maybe I have to give some definitions, because we have to know these definitions. The Earth revolve around the sun. We say the 1 year. It is duration 365.25 mean solar day. Here is the some astronomical tricks, because we use the tropical year for the length of the time used here. This depends the equinox points and equinox points. If the sun comes from one equinox to another equinox, we say the one tropical year pass. The duration of this one. And also year is divided 12 months. Each month also divided 30 day. Some is different, you know, 30, 31 or February is shorter. And also 7 days constitute. The day begins when we saw the upper edge of the sun in the eastern horizon, the upper sun, the sun upper parts. When we see, we say the day begin. When ends, the upper edge completely disappear from the western horizon. Here is some pictures from the internet show this situation. Maybe some others possible to see here. And if we go to the prayer times, the criteria not Arctic regions. This is generally accepted criteria. Also, maybe some confusions about these topics. The morning prayers time begin according to our observations. The sun below the horizon 8.5 degree. The Fajr lights and upper and white atmospheric conditions we see. And the end of this morning prayers, everybody accept this one, a few minutes before the sunrise. Noon prayer, duhur, the time of zuhur starts when the sun's east limb crosses the local meridian, not the middle of the sun. We are waiting a few minutes to cross the sun's west limb from the meridian. This is important for the criteria. And afternoon prayer, for example, this depends the shadow of the, for example, a road, a man, you can use anything. The shadow, the vertical road's shadow is equal to the shadow at the noon and plus one length of the road. This is very easy to calculate from the astronomical calculations. Here is important things to accept the criteria. If the criteria this kind, the solution is easy. Sunset prayers also accepted all Muslim world begins immediately after sunset. The sunset's upper limb disappears from the horizons. Here is we have to take into the refraction because the refraction effect of the Earth brings the objects to a little high, a little zenith directions. The refraction effect, if the sun on the horizon 35 arc minutes, and we have to add the diameter of the sun 16 arc minutes, the total 51 arc minutes, the refraction effects must be account to the calculation. So the last one, the evening prayer, begins when the reddish sky begins to spread completely and end sky is completely dark. The end time, our criteria,
The sky is completely dark. This angle after the sunset, it is about 10.5 degree. No, 10.5, it's my observations. So we can discuss this. Here is the sun, Fajr, Duhur, Maghrib, Isha times. Maybe we have to look a little to the celestial sphere. Here is the Earth. This is the rotation axis of the Earth. When we extend this axis to cross to the celestial sphere, we obtain the North Pole. Here is the equator, and here is the right angle. Every time this equator, right angle to the rotation axis, and when we cross the equator and horizons, we obtain the west, the other side east, the left side north, right side south. So this is another representation, and here's the celestial equator, also the Earth's equator. We extend to the celestial sphere, we obtain the equator, and the ecliptic plane here, there is a 23 degree and 26 arc minutes between these two orbital planes. This angle also depends the time, but it changes very, very small. During 100 years, maybe a few arc minutes, not important for this kind of calculations. And here is an example, the sun path. Here is the horizon. This is the 90 degree, the zenith direction. If the sun rise from the southeast, this is the winter time. We see very short, very little altitude from the horizon. It's about 25 degree. It's very short. If we look the 90 degree azimuth degree, this is the 21 March and 22 September. It depends to latitude also observer. The sun's core, here is the meridian, 28.5, here is the west. It looks M, but looking the other side. And after the March, the sun began a little north each day. Here's when we come here, 25th of June, the sun's altitude on the meridian increases. When the sun comes to the zenith, it depends the time of the day, latitude of the observer, also the declination of the sun. These three parameters combines for the solutions. I will show some small example for this. This is to see how the celestial sphere works, the Earth, ecliptic equator, and the intersection points, vernal equinox, so on. So here is the calculation spheric, celestial sphere. We use a spherical sphere, celestial sphere, to calculate the time, prayer times. Here is an example. Here is the star. We accept a sun, for example, here. We produce a triangle, 1 point pole, and another zenith, another star. And maybe I show here with my hand drawings. And if we want to solve the, for example, Maghrib time, the sun sets here, but we saw the sun on the horizon, but the actual sun from the refraction below the horizon is about 51 degrees. And we use this kind of spherical angle. The solution here, the cosine formula gives us the sun's angle, and also we can use when the sun is set, it's normally between these two angles, we can calculate and change its local time. Because we need the local time, because the prayer times depends to the local. And also we use our watch, it is a not local time, it is a regional time. And we have to convert using this kind of formula, and also we add to the refraction effect. We can find for each prayer times the local time when the prayer will be done. An example maybe here, it is not so important for you, and some formulas how can we produce. And here is, we have to know the some formula, but some of them depends to the time of the day, time of the year. How it change, we have to include to the formula. And Abdülaziz Bayındır give us some criteria for the articulations, and also Mr. Enis Doku, he is here now, I couldn't see. He's working upstairs. Has been generated a program for the prayer times. You can see it from these websites. But now the program not works for the articulations. Today afternoons, Abdülaziz Bey, Professor will give us some criteria, and we can do new program using this criteria. And I mean, very soon, I don't know, he will explain us very soon, a new calendar you can reach from these websites. And so, once more time, I want to give my appreciates about these organizations. Will be very benefit for all colleagues. And at the end of today, I hope we will reach a conclusion for the prayer times. Thanks. I finish my speech.
Thank you very much for that speech. Our next speaker is Imran Mustaq from... after this one, Sean. He is from Islam Abroad Norway, and he's going to do a speech on prayer times in Norway.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Auzu billahi minash-shaytanir-rajim. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Wassalatu wassalamu ala Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Biliniz tabi mi? Okay. Det er sikkert slitne av å høre så mye astronomi. Jeg er litt... Før jeg går over til engelsk, så bare tenkte jeg høre det som er lokalt her. Hvor mye astronomi har du fått med dere så langt? De som har fått med seg mer enn 50% kan rekke opp hånda. Okay. I will convert to English. My name is Imran Mushtaq. I have been given the honor from Islamic Council of Norway, Islamsk Råd Norge, to give this presentation. The General Secretary from Islamic Council of Norway had to, he was supposed to come. Last night I talked to him and he had some certain plans, private plans he had got to abroad, so he couldn't join you today. With me from Islamic Council, I have with me Brother Abdullah Suyuti. He is Imam in Trondheim and have been working on prayer time issue together with us. We have with Brother Zahiruddin Qazi from Bodo, and he also is working closely with us on the prayer time issue. And we have Imam Tayyib, who is in the Islamic Council and is part of the Council Committee. So I will just start with a simple question about what do you know? I forgot to tell a little bit about myself. I have been involved with Islamic Council of Norway since I finished my studies in Trondheim back in 95. I was part of the board. Now I have been more like a part of the committees, participating wherever I can. And but now I'm not part of the board right now. So what you know about, you have some general perceptions of Iran, I assume. How many of you know about Iran? Can you raise your hand? Yeah? Iran, Islamsk Råd Norge. So it's like less than 10%?
More than
10%? Okay. Is it a positive impression you have or a negative impression?
Positive,
that's good. Because lots of people think, is Iran more like a radical organization? Is this an unnecessary organization? We don't need any such stuff. Are they working for Islam and unity? The Muslim Ummah in Norway is an issue that we are, as the brother said, in the fiqh issues, we don't work very well together. We have a lot of solutions and our solution doesn't fit. And the cooperation we have is that I work for myself and you work for yourself, and we hope inshallah it will be solved. This is how inshallah always become in most of our cases. Everybody wants to work on their own. They want the best solution. They know the best solution. There are unnecessary discussions and accusations. Everybody accuses each other that you're not following Quran and Sunnah. I am the one following Quran and Sunnah. And as you mentioned, the society looks at Muslims and makes a wrong picture and make jokes of us. We had the same issue. This is the prayer time we're going to discuss now. We started with the issue of standardizing the Hijri calendar back in 1996. It took us 4 years to get a common method and 10 years to get majority of the Muslim organization on board. Muslims get a bad self-image. The youth, if you talk to them, they have an identity crisis because they can't relate to themselves like Muslims, or they don't do anything. They always fight. Muslims need dialogue in advance to be able to work together according to agreements and standards. And here where we are always lacking. We don't make time to agree, and we don't make time to make standards. As Allah subhanahu wa says in the Quran, verse 8, 46, and obey Allah and His Messenger, and fall into no disputes, lest you lose heart and your power depart, and be patient and persevering. For Allah is with those who patiently persevere. So things takes time. Be always on move. Be working with issues. Don't think, okay, I was not able to solve it tonight. our decision is not solvable. Sometimes take time. Some issues take time. And remember, dialogue in advance. About IRM and the Tafin group, the Islamic Council of Norway is the national umbrella organization for Muslim organizations and mosques in Norway. The history, is it an indicator here, do you think? There we go. The first mosque was initiated back in 1974, Islamic Cultural Center, which Montaigne belongs to. And most of the Muslims then departed from that platform and created new platforms, and we have divided and divided and divided, and we have more than 100 organizations in Norway, which is alhamdulillah is good, as long as we can work together. Some of the organizations have again cooperated in smaller groups, like these organizations. I will be referring them to Ahlus Sunnah Imam Council. You have the Tablighi movement, which have been dividing into many mosques, more than 50 mosques across Norway with small units. They will be called the Jamiat Ulama Norway. Then you have Tawfiq with a lot of branches across Norway, really small mosques coming up. Then you have now Rabita putting up a lot of branches. But what happened is that back in 1988, one event happened, and that was the first event Muslims was involved in against the bigger society, and that was the Rushdie case, if you remember it. And that even made Muslims think how to present Islam in the media. And everybody was saying, I am presenting Islam. And they started then to talk, have dialogue, and created a platform which we today call Islamic Council of Norway, ELN. So we created it in 1993. And from that time, from 1993, a lot of mosques have come on board. And now, as you see the time frame going forward, you see radicalization happening among youths. You see a lot of, from 74 until now, a lot of mosques have been established, as we were telling here in Tromsø about 93. You had your first mosque established in 93, right?
Yeah.
Same happened across Norway with different organizations. And now Muslims need to cooperate on many issues, and we need a common platform to talk. And now we see that after establishing the foundation, which are the mosques for prayers and religious affair, a lot of Muslim institutions need to be established. How to do the research on fatwa and issues like prayer times. How to do research on other areas. How to establish an Islamic bank. How to establish council for people getting married. All that, how to get Islamic food across the country. So all that requires common efforts, again, coordinated by Islamic Council of Norway. We are going to get the elderly wave, we are going to women participation issue, and more issues come in the future, and we need to handle them. This is a picture of telling you how many Muslims we are in Norway. The estimates will vary. People will say we are between 100,000 and 150,000 Muslims. The exact figure is how many Muslims are registered in mosques across Norway getting the governmental support. And that is 95,000 people. And then you have a lot of people coming on asylum, don't want to register, maybe coming from Iran and have no close relationship with mosques. So you can always estimate or guesstimate a figure up to more than 50,000 more people. Then divided. In Norway, you see the majority of the Muslims are living south, below the Arctic Circle. So it is between 48 degrees and 62. And then you have a couple of thousand Muslims living above Arctic Circle. The green figures represent how many Muslims are represented by Islamic Council of Norway. So Islamic Council are representing 9 out of the 10 largest mosques. 80% of the total registered members of mosques with more than 500 members in these mosques, the bigger mosques, are represented in Islamic Council. It's a lot of smaller mosques with smaller members in smaller areas, which they don't have capacity to follow up more like national issues, so they are not, for the time being, part of Islamic Council. But I always advise people, We need a common national platform, and we need people to work together. My statistic is, among 100 Muslims, one works, three works against him, and 94, what do they do? They sit and wait, they do nothing. And the same statistic for other religion would say, 10 out of 100 will be actively working. So you see, one is working for 100, and working against those three, which is fighting him. So we have big challenges. I just need to follow my time. It's more like the purpose in Norwegian. You can go to the web page and read this. It's more like to build a Muslim identity, get Muslims to work together. The main vision for Islamic Council of Norway is dialogue. I think Islamic Council is becoming a champion in this area. Media and communication. Islamic Council have a long experience in this area. Islamic Council is facilitating the networking, experience and competency. The areas where we need to have more focus is getting direction. How do we participate in our local communities? How do we make local communities succeed with Islamic identity? And here the mosque are doing a great job, but we also need to have a coordination and do more work to be active civilian borgere av Norge, as you call it. And then the area I was talking about, the research, art and culture, how to develop the solutions we need in Norway. A lot of those solutions defined by the FIC is for the areas where majority of the Muslims live, I suppose. And for the areas where we have the minority FIC, we have a lot of way to go. And we need a lot of cooperation there. This, what we call the IRN's Vision House, we take the four areas: dialogue, local community, research, media. Prayer times is one, in Avner Muzom is one of the areas, beside having a local calendar, Hijri calendar. It started with organization, mosques organizing themselves, IRN get organized. Now we are working on training, how to get the mosque Muslims trained to work in this field. Then we need to start inviting more people to work with it. Few persons can't take the whole busload or whatever you call it. And when the cooperation starts, where we are not yet at that point, we are doing some cooperation, but we are not there yet, then we need to start thinking about development. Just think about it. We got the separation between state and church recently. You know how this happened? You know Humanitarian Forum, the atheist organization in Norway? They have same number of members as Muslims, 80,000 members, right? Each member is paying 4,000 kron a year, making a lot of millions. Those money spent in doing those activities which make a state and church separated. Think about it. Each one of you member in a Muslim organization are not willing to pay 200 kron a year, or 250 kron a year. You're saying, you're getting the money from the state, so why should you pay more? And remember, today they separated state and church. Tomorrow we're getting a lot of elder people, and the day next would be they need to start saving money. And how will they save money? They'll start cutting the money from the budget. And where will they cut first? What do you think? The money given to the mosques, which you think is enough to run a mosque and Islamic activities. No, it is not. So we need to start developing our funds. We need to start developing activities to work on those areas. The offers which are given, Muslim Posten, is how to communicate between Muslims. It's a lot of communication within the Muslim organization and with other organizations. Getting that facility that we can bury our person who dies in Norway, different places in Norway. We have more than 400 communes, each commune has responsibility, and not everywhere we have a graveyard facility yet. So we need to work for it. Halal food, how to make sure that people are not making you eat non-halal food by just putting a label, it's halal. It's happening. It's more food sold as halal then it is produced as halal in slaughters. Remember that. Hijri calendar. How to make a common in day when your child is going to have a free from school. He need to have the common day. And how to have the prayer time that you can pray together and you can open iftar together. It's a lot of other activities. You get IRM, there's a few people working on behalf of like 100,000 Muslims. And they get a lot of requests. And you can't handle all the requests unless more people step up and work. Muslim Posting will solve some of them. You have something related to the society and media requiring attention, members requiring some attention, and interreligious dialogue required a lot of attention so far. So how is IRM organized? Remember, all the mosques, they are the owner of Islamic Council of Norway. Islamic Council of Norway does not exist without the mosques. So all the board and imams of those mosques are owner of Islamic Council. You can't say Islamic Council is something for themselves. They are working on behalf of those. These mosque member organizations send people into a council which have 3 to 4 meetings a year, and they have the select the IRM board. And in that board, you have different committees. You have this imam committee where the imam participates. Under this imam committee, they sit together, they're working according to Quran and Sunnah. They have some major issues to work with. Among those major issues I have been mentioning here is the work which was started in 96, getting the Hijri calendar standardized. It took us many years. Standardizing the prayer times, I set back in 95, and in 2000, when we started with the prayer times. The efforts it took to standardize the Hijri calendar and convincing people in mosque, standardizing the prayer times will take at least 10 times more effort. And that was back in my year 2000. Counseling, marriage counseling help, we have a lot of issues there. We need to have a fatwa research on those issues, and food, halal food. Just to let you know, since I'm very interested in this area too, you know what this is? It's a visibility map for the moon. Yesterday, it was the conjunction time for the moon. Moon, sun, and earth being measuring on the same line. Today, Saturday, we should be in the green area, be able to have visibility of Hilal. In Norway here, we have some always issues to observe Hilal. That's why we have. And the areas on Friday, if people say, I observed Hilal on an area where you don't have visibility curve, those people are always looking at something else than Hilal. Halal certification is a very advanced program. You can look into the website and learn about it. About the Taqweem, I have 15 minutes left, right?
12.
Development of prayer times calendar in Norway. The first establishment was Islamic Culture Center as a mosque. They started also establishing the prayer time calendar back in the 80s. And how do we develop prayer time calendars? Of course, we use almanac. We have a facility of almanac in Norway. People didn't have the astronomy background. People okay understood what we do in our home countries. Yes, we have sunrise, we have sunset, and we have noon. Those times are given in the almanac for each city, major cities in Norway. So people started creating their prayer times based on almanac. And Asr, how do you calculate Asr? Oh, you find the middle of Zohr and Maghrib. And how do you Isha? Oh, in our home countries, it's always 90 minutes. And before sunrise and after sunrise, sunset. So, are you able to create 5 prayers timetables? Yes, it's easy. But is 90 minutes correct for areas above 48 degrees? Or maybe 60 degrees in Oslo? This is the issue we have started working with, according to Sharia. So what happened is, if you look back to the division of the mosques, at that time everybody was fighting each other and everybody wanted to have their own prayer time calendar. So what happened? We got a lot of prayer time calendars with sunset, sunrise, and some other times with 2 to 5 minutes variation. Everybody said, my timetable is best. And they was copying from each other. Back in 94-95, while I was in Trondheim, we had brothers there who was starting to work with on the fiqh issue. How can we follow the fatwa about implementing the Makkah time in Trondheim for the prayer times? And the biggest challenge was not getting the mosque board and imam agreeing on it. The biggest challenge was to get each single individual member agreeing on it. People said, no, I can see the sun. I don't want to follow your table. I will follow sunrise, sunset, whatever it is. We got the prayer time table on Islam.com. We started to give this prayer time table for many cities. It was based on the ICC table. After the 90s, discussions started about prayer time issues for the extreme areas. Muslims started to establish mosques in the 90s, different areas in Norway. We started the initial work for Ramadan timetables back for 2000, thinking, what will happen in 2015 when we get Ramadan in the extreme summer? Will people be fasting 20 hours? Will people start working for it 15 years ahead? And guess what? People don't care until 2 years before. Now people are starting to give pressure. Please make a solution. 2003, Ahl-e Sunnah Imam Council Mosque standardized their prayer timetables. What they used was, at that time we have been using Dr. Shoket, Khalid Shoket from moonsighting.com. He had been working on this field for many, many years. He had a lot of programs developed. We have brother Manzoor, who also had the program for Salat prayers and Moon Calculator. So we, at this mosque, at that time, created a timetable with Isha and Fajr based on 1/7 method, dividing night in 1/7. And still keeping the Asr as 2-time schedule, and sunrise, sunset, and noon standard. The Jamiat Ulama Norway, WHE network, they also started discussing 2006 to 2009 and ended up in 2011 using Dr. Shoket's new methodology about variation in the latitude, variation in the degree according to location and where in the year you are to calculate a varying part of between 11 to 18 degree, 11 to 15 degree. So they are combining the winter time where the Fajr and sunrise is a bit more than 2 hours, and using almost this method to reduce it to close to 90 minutes, and using summertime 1/7 method. Then you had in Brother Yuti with us today. He much later initiated the work about how to improve the situation in Trondheim back in 2010. And again, he created a lot of documentation, a lot of work there. Mashallah, it's on the websites, and you can talk to him in the break. And finally now in 2012, we get a lot of motivated people across Norway now to establish this Takvim group, which is now more effectively working on how we can standardize, what methodology we should need to use. And picture about Brother Abdullah presenting this in the Imam Committee. And the question we have is, does Norway experience extreme periods? Most of the people say yes, but we don't get any scholars agreeing on it yet. Does Sharia normal rules apply for the prayer times we have? And those rules, does they apply in abnormal zones? And are we an abnormal zone? Or how do you define an abnormal zone? Because the issue is not about getting a solution. The issue is, we need to get defined, is Norway between 60 and 66 degree abnormal? Is Norway from 66 to 70 an abnormal zone? And if it is abnormal zone, then the getting solutions are easier. For Oslo, for the longest day, we have almost 4 prayers prayed within 6 hours. Think about it. We have 24 hours a day, and we hurry up, pray 4 of our prayers within 6 hours. In winter, we spend 7 hours finishing our 4 prayers, and then we have rest of the day with no prayers. We can do our other prayers, but But if you look at the life cycle, the day cycle they had during Prophet Muhammad's time, maybe it's not a Quranic and Hadith argument about using Makkah Medina time, but think about that Sahaba and people living in those areas during Prophet Muhammad's time and after his time. They was following a balanced life cycle during a day. Right? And they don't put 6 hours in prayers and then they don't have any prayer time. And then we get a lot of fatwas, like the fatwa from Al-Hazar. And then we get the counter fatwas about using the Dajjal hadith or not. Is the Dajjal hadith valid for us or not? So we are like in a jungle of fatwas and anti-fatwas. So there is no sunrise sunset for 6 months, 3 months, you'd have a daytime constantly. And I got discussion with some brothers. We have an international organization called Islamic Crescent Observation Project. They're also running this issue together with the Organization of Islamic Countries and the Fiqh Council. And they're also developing some methods there. Brother Shaukat in Brother Ode in ICOP is also developing this software called Accurate Time Prayer. And I forgot to mention Brother Suyut Abdullah have also created software here. We also working our local software. We have no problem calculating the prayer times in Norway as long as we agree on the principles. The discussion is always about reference to sunrise, sunset, and noon time. We have a lot of discussion on asr timing, one time, two time shadow. And I was even surprised to discuss with a lot of imams that they don't consider the initial shadow to be added when you're calculating one time shadow. They say one time shadow is one time shadow. So even though you're living in extreme position where your initial shadow could be longer than one time shadow, you have a problem. You get a discussion on actual sunset time. When is actual sunset time? People say, oh no, I will have my break my iftar now according to this timetable. And the other guy sitting beside will say, I will break after 3 minutes because my timetable is correct and it says it's after 3 minutes. So how do you get people agreeing on something? Fajr start. There I think more or more for areas below 66 degree is landing on 1/7 method, but still within the work Takwim group we are working on saying if we are abnormal zone, why do we stick to 1/7 method? What should be the solution? But again, we need to finalize, are we normal or abnormal zone? The Dajjal Hadith have created a lot of discussions. People have huge arguments about for and against, and how to solve the mix of matters and transition periods. Because at the end, we will be adding up normal timetable, and then difficult time will be calculating according to different matters, and then we will have a transition periods getting between the normal and the calculated difficult area timetables. And which method will you use for the transition period? Again, you will get into new troubles. We have the full expertise in Norway to calculate the prayer timetables as long as we can agree upon common principles and standards. Most of the fatwas given to us are a variety of potential solutions, but no fatwa gives us a clear guideline for which area should be defined as abnormal zone. We are most confident that Muslims in Norway together will agree upon the best possible solution as long as we're clear about the status for us, which Sharia rules applies for us, for normal or abnormal. And then the solution must be within the realm of Sharia, Quran and Sunnah, because otherwise we'll not get an agreement. But it should, it need to take into account the local situation. And I think the people in the local area are more suitable to come up with a solution as long as we agree upon the problem, what is the problem. And the problem is we are not agreeing upon the problem. So I will skip from here. I think I have used my time, right? JazakAllah khair. And just final slide for the Iran summary. This is the like extra slides I had for the other presentation. We need to work together. Best solutions takes time and efforts, so don't give up. We should have a national dialogue. Together we stand stronger, and the difficult part is to agree upon a problem. The solution is much easier. And volunteer work creates requires willpower, opportunity, and capacity. It's not given very easily. And I would recommend people to be part of the national corporation, which is for Norway, Islamic Council of Norway. JazakAllah khair.
Thank you very much for that speech.